I thank Mark for inviting me to give this seminar talk. And let me say that all the work which I'm going to describe today is jointly with Andrei Rapinchuk. And it began here when we visited the institute the last time. And it's not yet completely done. There are still some open questions which I will describe towards the end of the talk. But some of this work has involved some interesting elements in Zariski-dense subgroups. And we discovered those elements because Margulis needed them for the Auslander problem and so on, so he asked us. But later it turned out that for this isospectrality question, we could use those elements inside arithmetic groups to give a reasonably complete solution for the question whether one can hear the shape of a drum for locally symmetric spaces. And these elements were produced by periodic methods, even though your group may be inside a real semisimple group. In fact, even in a compact Lie group, which very real, Zariski density will mean density in the ordinary topology. But to produce such elements, you still need periodic methods. So, we didn't use random walks. Since our work, there have been many other construction of these elements, but they use random walks or probabilistic methods. But our methods didn't require those. Okay, and they give us, you know, very good supply of those elements. So the problem which I want to discuss is, can one hear the shape of a drum? So this was formulated in this very nice way by Mark Kass. And the question is, given a compact Riemannian manifold, you have the Laplace operator and you have the eigenvalues. So the spectrum is the set of eigenvalues counted with multiplicity. So you keep the multiplicity into account. And the question is whether knowing this spectrum, can you figure out what the isometry type of the Riemannian manifold is? Compact Riemannian manifold without boundary. And the reason for shape of a drum and hearing it is because when we beat a drum, the harmonics, the sound which it produces, is related to the eigenvalues of the Laplace operator. And soon after this question was formulated, or maybe within a few years of the question was formulated, John Milner gave the first examples of tori of dimension 16, which came from E8 direct sum E8 lattice and the ordinary z to the power 16 lattice. And we showed that the answer is in general negative. And then Sunada, so T. Sunada gave a general method to construct counterexample. And in fact, I will describe that. So the method is really simple and was already known to algebraic number theorists because they knew how to construct number fields which were not isomorphic but which had the same Dedekind zeta function. And the construction was completely parallel to that. And Sunada, I'm sure, learned about the method in number theory and he copied it for manifolds and the method is following. So you start with a manifold, compact M tilde, and suppose it covers M regularly with a fundamental, you know, pi c, pi is the covering transformation group. And suppose pi contains two subgroups, H1 and H2, so pi is finite. So you have a finite cover M tilde of M, and H1 and H2 are two subgroups which are not conjugate. But they are almost conjugate in the sense, not conjugate, but almost conjugate. So this simply means that any conjugacy class inside pi, take any conjugacy class. So take an element and take all its conjugates, and then take the intersection of this conjugacy class with H1 and H2, you get same number of elements.
Same number of elements.
That's right. So each conjugacy class in pi meets H1 and H2 in equal number of elements. So this is a fancy way of saying that pi modulo H1 and pi modulo H2, when you take the regular representation coming from these, they are isomorphic as pi modules. Okay, so, and one can construct such examples of pi and H1 and H2 rather easily, and I will not even try to do that because those are very well-known examples. Now you look at M tilde modulo H1 and M tilde modulo H2 and call it M2 and here M1. So M1 and M2 are isospectral. But not isomorphic. They are not conjugate in the full isometry group.
This might not be the full isometry.
Yeah, so in the full isometry group, they are not conjugate. Okay, and so such examples are not hard to construct, and therefore you have a whole supply of manifold. But you see, the point to note, and this is very important for us, is that M1 and M2, though they are not isometric, they have a common cover. So let's have a definition. So the definition is two such manifolds, M1 and M2, are commensurable if they admit a common finite seated cover. So the question is, can one reformulate Markov's question to say that if you have two isospectral manifolds, then they must have a common cover, so they are commensurable. And this turned out to be also not correct. So there are examples, in fact, even in the arithmetic situation of locally symmetric spaces where things fail, and the first example was constructed by Lubotsky, Ismuel, and Wisne. And you see, the idea there is something I will discuss in greater detail later. So the idea is, you can construct division algebras D1 and D2 already over Q, such that these division algebras are neither isomorphic nor anti-isomorphic. So the corresponding semisimple algebraic groups are not isomorphic. But locally, these division algebras are isomorphic. I mean, they give you same semisimple groups. So locally, these division algebras are isomorphic or anti-isomorphic. And once you have such examples, then one knows from Langland's correspondence that the corresponding locally symmetric spaces, which I will describe in more detail later, the corresponding locally symmetric spaces will be isospectral. And since the division algebras are not isomorphic, are anti-isomorphic, the corresponding groups are not isomorphic over Q, and therefore the corresponding locally symmetric spaces will not be commensurable at all. Okay, so such example. So you see, so even reformulation of Markov's question is not good enough. You know, the reformulation whether two manifolds which are isospectral must be commensurable is false too. And so one has to reformulate the question. Okay, but you know, there was something interesting which isospectrality implies, and this fact was very crucial for us. So the isospectrality implies that a length of closed geodesics. So you take closed geodesics on M1 and M2. So you take set of lengths of closed geodesics on M1 and M2 are equal. This for the locally symmetric case. So for in general, there will be no answer. You see, it's really too much to expect that for general class of Riemannian manifolds, we will be able to answer these questions. I mean, in view of all these examples and so on. So we will concentrate on locally symmetric spaces. So for those of you who have only vague familiarity with locally symmetric spaces, let me define. So you start with a semi-simple Lie group, and K be maximal compact. And then you look at G mod K. This carries a Riemannian metric, which is very symmetric. So each point, you have a involution which reverses geodesics. And so you have this space X equals G mod K, so symmetric space. And suppose gamma is a subgroup inside G, torsion free, discrete co-compact, then you can look at M equals X mod gamma, and that's a compact locally symmetric space. You can also work with gamma, which is not co-compact, but large in the sense that you have finite co-volume and so on. And those things are called lattices. So, so a locally symmetric space is something which locally looks like a symmetric space. And so you divide X by a subgroup of isometries, a convenient subgroup will be inside G. So such a thing is called a locally symmetric space. And we will hopefully, this class of manifold is easy to understand because, you know, it's very concrete given by Lie groups, semi-simple groups, and discrete subgroups, which luckily we know much about. For example, we know arithmeticity in higher rank, so we might be able to use arithmetic methods too. So the question we will address is only for this class of manifolds, namely locally symmetric spaces. And for locally symmetric spaces, using trace formula, Vardarajan and Doastrema, in general, and for rank 1 by Ganguly, it follows that isospectrality of such manifolds implies that set of lengths of closed geodesics are equal. I'm not counting multiplicity of lengths. So in isospectrality, I'm counting eigenvalues up to multiplicity, yeah, for the Laplace operator. But when I say set of lengths, I mean just set of lengths without counting multiplicity. Okay, so now we can study, instead of isospectral manifolds, you see, we have no way to compute eigenvalues of the Laplace operator. Even in the simplest case of Riemann surfaces, you know, even for congruent subgroups, we do not yet know the full Selberg's conjecture. So there is no real way to compute eigenvalues and even get bound on eigenvalues for Laplace operator. We do not know what kind of numbers we get, transcendence and so on. So it's really nice that we have such a result. And so my question which we will address here will be, suppose M1, M2 are two. So we will concentrate on locally symmetric spaces, two locally symmetric spaces, which are of finite volume. So, you know, we are able to relax the condition that they are compact, which are of finite volume and are and are iso length. Iso length meaning lengths of closed geodesics for each one is the same set. Okay. What can we say about the relationship between and M2? Okay, so that's the question. And in fact, I will weaken this question a little more. So suppose the lengths are denoted by LM1 and LM2, then I will take rational multiples of the lengths, and suppose these sets are equal. So this is a new definition. If up to rational multiple, if the lengths are equal, then we will say that these are length commensurable. Then M1, M2 are length commensurable. Yes?
From the spectrum, you get the volume and then your local rigidity. But now you just throw it.
All the structure has been thrown out.
Everything away, just keeping this.
That's right. So it's a much weaker information available to us. And you see, it's better to weaken the condition of iso length to length commensurability. Because you see, from Sunada's example, you know, the best you can expect is commensurability. So if two manifolds have same cover, then, you know, closed geodesics here will have length which are multiples of lengths here. So only up to integral multiples you will know the lengths. See if they are going to be. So which means that coming back to M1 and M2, since the integral multiples, some integral multiples are the same, it means that the lengths are only commensurable. So given a length here, some rational multiple of that length will be a length here, and vice versa. So this weakened form of the question about length commensurable manifold, what is the relationship? So what can we say anything about such M1 and M2. Okay. And the answer turns out to be that we can say a lot. Okay. And so let us work out a formula for the length. So, you know, the metric on a symmetric space, which I didn't describe, is always the Killing form metric. So we will take the Killing form, and we will make some remarks about other possible invariant metrics, which are up to a scalar multiple, you know, the Killing form metric. Okay, so the formula for length is the following. So suppose I take x mod gamma, that's our m in that notation. Then closed geodesics are in bijective correspondence with semi-simple elements in gamma. Yeah, so we are working with a semi-simple group G. You can assume that it's linear adjoint group. And then for a linear group, you have the notion of semi-simplicity. You know, you can diagonalize it over algebraic closure. So semi-simple elements in gamma correspond bijectively to closed geodesics. Now, given a gamma, such a gamma, semi-simple, you embed it in a maximal torus. So you fix any maximal torus you like. And then I want to write the length of the closed geodesic, so which I will denote by L gamma for the length of the corresponding closed geodesic. And that is nothing but square root of log alpha gamma square summed over alpha running over roots of G over with respect to T. So you have a maximal torus T then you look at the roots of G with respect to T. You know, classification of semi-simple groups is through root systems and so on. But note that I'm not demanding that T be a split torus. So T is any maximal torus. So when we talk of roots, I mean over complex numbers. You go to algebraic closure and, you know, things is split and then you take the roots. So you take the log of, and you know, alpha gamma will be some eigenvalue, you know, in the adjoint representation. So you are taking logs of these things, natural logs, and take the absolute value of the natural log, square it and sum. So for example, if we are dealing with a real rank one situation. So for example, SON1 or SPN1 or SUN1, you know, these familiar groups. And for these, this sum is actually a sum up to integral multiple, one thing, because I'm looking, so I'm looking at absolute value of these characters, you know, these roots. And since the rank is one, up to multiple, there is only one root which plays any role here. You know, you can have several roots, but when you take the absolute value, the real rank being one, you get, you know, the real part of the character group is one dimensional. So there is essentially, yeah, because, you know, when you change gamma by a conjugate, you can change the torus by the same conjugate, and then roots will become conjugates too. So, it's conjugacy invariant. Okay, so for R rank 1 group, you will, you know, your formula will be L gamma equals some integer n, because, you know, that root will appear with multiplicity. You know, lots of roots will all give you the same thing. So it will be n log alpha gamma. And where n will depend on the group, the ambient semisimple group. Okay, so now suppose I have L gamma and L gamma prime. In other words, I'm dealing with two groups, G and G prime, and I am looking at gamma and gamma prime. And for gamma in gamma and gamma prime in gamma prime, I'm looking at the length of the corresponding closed geodesics on x mod gamma and x prime mod gamma prime. Okay, so I'm trying to compare the length. So you see, when I compare the length, I will have square root n by square root n prime log alpha gamma by log alpha prime gamma prime. That will be the length. So this is an algebraic number, but ratio of logs tend to be transcendental numbers. So suppose I give you two algebraic numbers. You see, if I'm dealing with arithmetic groups, then alpha gamma and alpha prime gamma prime will be algebraic numbers. And I will, you know, these algebraic numbers and their conjugates, so alpha gamma, so you see you have alpha gamma and the conjugate algebraic number. And so you see these will be logs of algebraic numbers. You know, the absolute value can be forgotten because absolute value is alpha gamma times alpha gamma bar, which are both algebraic numbers. And so I'm looking at logs of two algebraic numbers. And if these algebraic numbers are not multiplicatively dependent, that is, some power of one is not equal to some other power of the other, then the ratio by Hilbert's seventh problem, Gelfand-Schneider theorem, will be a transcendental number. So this is a transcendental number. Unless alpha gamma and alpha prime gamma prime are multiplicatively dependent. Yeah, so that's clear. and which means that the length ratios can be rational, even algebraic, only if alpha gamma and alpha prime gamma prime, these two numbers coming from two different, possibly different G and G prime and gamma prime, are actually related. Now, in higher rank, the formula is, you know, involves many sums. But there is a conjecture of Sanuel, which says the following. So given n algebraic numbers, say g1, g2, gn, which are multiplicatively independent, that is g1 to the power n1, a1, a2, an, equals 1 implies so if you have n algebraic numbers which are multiplicatively independent, which means that the logs are independent over Q, then the field generated by these n algebraic numbers over Q has transcendence degree equals n. So this is a very hard open conjecture in transcendental number theory. So given n multiplicatively independent algebraic numbers, the logs generate field of right transcendence degree. Now, see, in rank one case, which is already very interesting because all these constant curvature manifolds like hyperbolic spaces, complex hyperbolic spaces, and quaternionic hyperbolic spaces, they are already interesting. And for those, you don't need the conjecture. Rank one case, it's Hilbert's seventh problem, which we already know the answer. But see, if you have higher rank, then this sum is not a single sum. And then what one does is, say you have L gamma and L gamma prime, I want to compare them. So this will be, so among log alpha gammas, you choose P of them which form a basis for the logs, yeah, you know, over Q. So you take the set of logs which appear in this formula and take the Q span of them. You know, these may be transcendental, irrational numbers or whatsoever. And you take the Q span of these logs and take a basis. So suppose it has P elements. So L gamma is a quadratic form in these P elements. Yeah, because these are quadratic polynomials in logs. And I'm looking at P of them, lambda 1, lambda P. And you get a quadratic polynomial. And here, you will get another quadratic polynomial in some other numbers, lambda Q. Okay? And if these logs coming from gamma and gamma prime were independent, then Sanuel's conjecture will say that lambda 1. So if lambda 1, lambda p, and lambda 1 prime, lambda q prime are independent, when I say independent, I mean over rational numbers, will imply that q lambda 1, lambda p by q prime lambda is transcendental by Sanuel's. So once again, if these eigenvalues were independent, then the ratio of lengths will be a transcendental number. So there is no possibility to get rational multiples of lengths. So now this leads to, you know, I mean, I will quickly write down a definition, and then you will see the relevance of this. So definition, given gamma 1, gamma 2 inside g1, g2 respectively, we will say, that gamma 1 in gamma 1 and gamma 2 in gamma 2 are weakly commensurable. If some eigenvalue of gamma 1, some non-trivial eigenvalue, equals. Yes? That's right. We do use it in another context, but I will mention that if the time permits. Yeah, six exponential theorem is not good enough here, but it's good enough for certain things. Yeah. So we will say that gamma 1 and gamma 2 are weakly commensurable if some non-trivial eigenvalue of gamma 1 equals an eigenvalue of gamma 2. Okay. And I don't need to know which eigenvalue is this. And we do not need to know eigenvalue in which representation, as long as in some representation, some eigenvalue. You see, I am looking at representations of G1 and G2. And you see, if you have one faithful representation, then eigenvalues come from the multiplicative group generated by eigenvalues from this representation. You see, if you fix one faithful representation of G1, then in any representation, the eigenvalues which arise come from the multiplicative group generated by eigenvalues in the given faithful representation. Yeah, because these are algebraic representations. You see, semi-simple group, all representations are algebraic. So, yeah, is this point clear? I don't care whether your eigenvalues, which are equal, come from the adjoint representation or any other representation. Because restricting to adjoint representation will give me only certain number of eigenvalues. I allow the possibility of your choosing a representation for one and another representation for the other and saying that, you know, I have found equal eigenvalues. Okay, now gamma 1 and gamma 2 are weakly commensurable if given a semi-simple element. See, we are interested only in semi-simple elements because they are the ones which give rise to closure D6. So we don't care about non-semi-simple elements in gamma 1 and gamma 2. There could be plenty of them, but we don't care. So these are weakly commensurable if given gamma 1 in gamma 1, semi-simple of infinite order. So the element should be semi-simple and of infinite order. There exists a gamma 2 in gamma 2, same properties, semi-simple of infinite order, and weakly commensurable. To gamma 1, and vice versa. So this is an equivalence relation. So if you are given an element in gamma 2, you should be able to produce a similar element in gamma 1. Okay, now a quick example of weak commensurability will be commensurability. Gamma 1, gamma 2 commensurable will imply weakly commensurable. So weak commensurability is a weaker notion. So recall that two groups are said to be commensurable if they lie inside the same group and the intersection is a finite index in both. Yeah, so commensurability means that the intersection makes sense, they lie in the same group, and in that group, the intersection is a finite index in both gamma 1 and gamma 2. So given an element in gamma 1, which is semi-simple, you take a power, it will lie in gamma 1 intersection gamma 2, because this is a finite index in gamma 1, and that power will lie in gamma 2 because it's in the intersection. But you see, power of an element has eigenvalues which are powers of the eigenvalue. So the weak commensurability requirement is fulfilled. See, power of an eigenvalue is an eigenvalue in a symmetric power representation. So you have no problem. You know, you can work with symmetric power representation. You understand? So I allowed myself the freedom to choose the representation was with this view in mind. So if I take an element, some power lies in the intersection, therefore in gamma 2, but then these two elements are weakly commensurable. So that also says that things can go badly wrong. So suppose gamma is inside G, your favorite group like SON1. Gamma could be arithmetic. Now, you know, Gromov observed for rank 1 groups that if you take a lattice in a rank 1 group and take large powers of elements, then they generate a normal subgroup which is free. So it's infinite index. Yeah, so inside any given gamma lattice inside a rank 1 group, if you take large finite power of each element, then the group generated is a free group of infinite index. So this was Gromov. In fact, he didn't give a complete proof, but complete proofs have been written down. So now, if I work with gamma and a subgroup generated by powers of elements, then these are weakly commensurable, because any element is weakly commensurable to any power of it, as I mentioned. So if I replace gamma by a subgroup which contains powers of every element in gamma, then these two things are weakly commensurable. So it's not true that a group which is weakly commensurable to another group is commensurable. You know, you can have infinite index subgroups which are commensurable. So one needs to be very careful. Okay, so the definition of weak commensurability is given here, and you see it was suggested by that length formula, because as I explained, if lengths are commensurable, then in rank 1 from Hilbert's seventh problem, you already see that elements in gamma 1 and gamma 2, which give you commensurable geodesics, they must have related eigenvalues, at least one of them. And in higher rank, same conclusion holds, provided you knew Sanuel's conjecture. Okay, so isospectrality implies iso length, which implies length commensurability, and I am going to prove theorems about length commensurable manifolds. So let us write down a series of theorems. So now I will assume that gamma 1, gamma 2 are two finitely generated Zariski-dense weakly commensurable subgroups of G1, G2 respectively. So G1 and G2 are two real semisimple Lie groups. You know, you can take SON1, for example, or SUP1, whatsoever you want to do. But these are two finitely generated Zariski-dense weakly commensurable subgroups. They could even be free groups, because, you know, you can always realize free group as a Zariski-dense subgroup in any given semisimple group. So they could be very thin subgroups. Now, first theorem is that the trace fields generated by elements in gamma 1, respectively gamma 2, are same. So we are dealing with 1K. Yeah, you know, these groups are G1 and G2, semisimple groups, real. And you have finitely generated Zariski-dense subgroups. So you can take generators of these groups and take the field generated by those, entries from those generators. So you have a common field K over which everything is defined. Yeah, given a semisimple group, it's always defined over some finitely generated field. You know, it's defined over R, but using finite number of equations. So, and then I will throw in, inside this finitely generated field, matrix entries from a finite set of generators of gamma 1 and gamma 2, and work with, you know, any such K. Now, what is the trace field? So you look at trace of add gamma 1. Gamma 1 in gamma 1. So you take the adjoint representation and take the traces under the adjoint representation of elements in gamma 1. Similarly for traces in gamma 2. And you will get then two fields, K1 and K2, inside K. You will get two fields, K1 and K2, inside K. Because, you know, the traces will lie in K. Everything is with entries in K. So the first thing to note is that K1 and K2, the fields generated by traces, have to be same. And this is already very surprising. Because, see, I don't even care what eigenvalues were equal and in which representation. Just one eigenvalue in some representation of some, you know, gamma 1 equals. But that already tells me that in the adjoint representation, at least the traces are determined. So the trace fields are the same. And you know, why are the traces important? Because if the group is going to be arithmetic, then you will construct a number field which will be the defining number field for arithmeticity. And that number field is nothing but the field generated by traces under the adjoint representation. So you are able to capture, you know, if you were in arithmetic situation, you are able to capture the defining number field from weak commensurability. Now, so this is theorem 1. And this theorem 1 is valid even in non-arithmetic situation. So as long as you are working with a field of characteristic 0 and everything is happening over that field, then the trace fields are the same. You don't need any arithmetic assumption. Now, pardon me? Yes, yes. Everything which I will say now will be for any rank. And in fact, everything which I will say now for some time will require nothing from transcendental number theory. You know, the problem of using transcendental number theory, you know, Sanual conjecture or Hilbert seventh problem, it's only when I want to relate lengths to eigenvalues. Okay? So once I have defined weak commensurability and concentrate on studying weak commensurability, and length is not in the picture, then logs don't come in. Therefore, transcendental number theory doesn't come in. Theorem 2 says that G1 and G2 are of same type. You know, these two semi-simple groups could have been very different. You know, one could have been type AN and other type CN. But that's not the case. G1 and G2 are of same type, or one is of type BN and the other of type CN. So these are the only possibilities. And you know, the reason is that knowing two Zariski-dense subgroups being weakly commensurable allows us to read off the wild group. And the wild group determines the root system except for the ambiguity of BN and CN. So you will know that these types are either identical, so if one is of type AN, then the other is of type AN. Or at worst, one could be of type BN and the other type CN. But that's the only ambiguity. And this ambiguity is real, not because of the method. We will construct examples of locally symmetric spaces, one of type BN and other of type CN, which are length commensurable after scaling. So you scale by a quadratic irrational number. You would modify the metric by a one quadratic irrational number, and they become isolength. So BN and CN is not failure of our method, but in fact, it does occur. Now, these two theorems are general theorems about general Zariski-dense subgroups. Now, we will concentrate on lattices. Same hypothesis as in theorem 1. So two weakly commensurable Zariski-dense subgroups. OK, so that's right. So you see, I cheated a little bit. When you are dealing with arithmetic groups, even in product, so we can work with irreducible arithmetic groups. So you know, there could be many real and complex factors. but the underlying algebraic group over number field is absolutely simple, and by embedding your number field in several different ways in real and complex numbers, you can get different groups. For example, you can construct lattices in SUPQ times SUP prime Q prime, as long as P plus Q is P prime plus Q prime. And you can have an irreducible arithmetic group, which will come from an absolutely simple group, but over a number field which admits two real embeddings at least. In one real embedding, you get SUPQ, and in another real embedding, you get SUP prime Q prime. And in third embedding, it may be the compact unitary group. So you see, the way arithmetic groups arise in product is starting with an absolutely simple group or a number field, and then using its real and complex embeddings. Yeah? So for example, here, there could be also SLP plus Q complex numbers. So I can have a product of this kind, 3. So you have a complex embedding, which will, of course, give you SLP plus Q over complex numbers, and two real embeddings, which give you this. So, you know, so even though you are looking at not a simple group, but you are looking at irreducible arithmetic groups. So I should have been, careful, but I think you see, the group may not have been so irreducibility takes care of this. So a lattice is said to be irreducible if it's not a product up to commensurability. So you cannot write a subgroup of, so a lattice gamma is said to be irreducible if it's not lambda 1 times lambda 2 up to commensurability, which means that you cannot replace gamma by a subgroup of finite index, which is direct product of two groups.
So you didn't assume it was a lattice.
Yeah, that's true. So there I should assume. Yeah, no, what I'm saying is that my statements will be guided by this idea that I'm working with finally irreducible arithmetic groups. So here, for theorem 1 and theorem 2, I should assume that G1, G2, absolutely simple. Because in arithmetic situation, this is what is required. Yeah, because otherwise, of course, I cannot talk of type. Okay, so theorem 2 says that. Now I will impose more conditions. So now I will assume that gamma 1 and gamma 2 are lattices. Then the third theorem says that if gamma 1 is arithmetic, then so is gamma 2. So for example, if I give you two isospectral manifolds, for example, hyperbolic spaces, two isospectral ones, and if you knew that they both have, they are compact, of course, by isospectrality requirement is compactness. So if one of them is arithmetic, then the other one has to be arithmetic. I mean, that's really interesting. Already for hyperbolic spaces, if you knew that one of them is arithmetic and the other one is just isospectral to the first one, then the other one has to be arithmetic, and we didn't compute any eigenvalues. Just, you know. So if gamma 1 is arithmetic, then so is gamma 2. Theorem, if G1 is of type different from,
to clarify,
yes?
The assumptions are the lengths, this commensurability of lengths. It's not isospectral.
That's right, precisely. Because see, isospectrality, we cannot, it's gone, completely gone. So we need the weaker requirement.
Every theorem is about.
That's right. In fact, not even lengths, up to commensurability lengths. So if you have length commensurability, then gamma 1 arithmetic implies gamma 2. In fact, the only condition which I need is that these two lattices should be weakly commensurable. And that's forced on us by the requirement that these are isolength or length commensurable using number theory. But see, I don't want to use transcendental number theory as far as possible. So our formulations are all in terms of weak commensurability, which is an interesting notion in itself and which has interesting consequences in itself for algebraic group theory. So if G1 is of type different from An, D2N plus 1, E6. So if you exclude these types, then gamma 1, gamma 2 are commensurable. That is, G1 over the defining number field, which I will K1, so you see, real groups may, I mean, we don't even know that real groups were isomorphic, but we are saying much more than that. We are saying that if gamma, if G1 is of type different from An, D2N plus 1, and E6, so gamma 1. So if G1 is of type different from one of these types, then gamma 1 and gamma 2 are commensurable. That is, you can talk of their common intersection. They lie in the same semisimple group, and they have common intersection of finite index, which in terms of algebraic group, it means that the underlying semisimple algebraic groups over the number fields which define arithmeticity, those number fields from theorem 1 are same. So I have denoted by K, the common number field which give you arithmeticity for gamma 1 and therefore for gamma 2. So then the groups G1 and G2 considered as algebraic groups or these number fields are actually isomorphic. So you can identify these groups. And once you can identify these groups, then gamma 1 and gamma 2 get identified up to commensurability. So in other words, already inside SLN, you can have lots of different lattices. For example, using division algebras of degree n, you can have lots of different lattices. And these lattices are, in general, not commensurable. So weak commensurability is a very strong condition somehow. And it tells you that except for type an, d2n plus 1, and e6, for example, if you worked with SOPQ, and if you have two lattices, maybe for different p and q, if you have two lattices which turned out to be weakly commensurable, then they are actually commensurable. And the corresponding quadratic forms must be identical. You know, to define quadratic, SOPQ, you need a quadratic form or a quaternionic quadratic form. So you will know the quaternion division algebra underlying the quadratic form, and you will say that these two quaternions are same, or if they were ordinary quadratic forms, then you will know that these are same quadratic forms. So except for these types, actually the arithmetic groups have to be commensurable. And then suppose is a lattice and gamma 2 Zariski-dense, weakly commensurable to gamma 1, then often gamma 2 is discrete. So weak commensurability, which is looking at eigenvalue in some representation, also gives you discreteness. Of course, it cannot give you that gamma 2 is a lattice, as I said, from Gromov examples. You can replace every element of gamma by a fixed large power, and then you get a subgroup of infinite index, which is clearly weakly commensurable, but not a lattice. So one can ask whether given a lattice and something weakly commensurable, is that weakly commensurable thing has to be a discrete subgroup? And the answer is yes. often, but the word often is important here. So the groups could be, so this often means G1, G2 non-Archimedean semi-simple group. So a semi-simple group or non-Archimedean fields are allowed too. So in all our work actually works with S-arithmetic groups. Our real field is not important as long as you have a valued field. So periodic field is allowed. So for example, G1, G2 non-Archimedean semi-simple groups are G1, G2 admit a maximal torus which is compact. So if you are dealing with real groups, we need, in our proof, we need to have the groups admitting maximal tori which are compact. So for example, SLN, the proof will not work. SL2, it will work, but not for SLN. You know, existence of maximal torus, which is compact, is equivalent to existence of discrete series. We don't need discrete series, but we certainly make use of tori, which are maximal and compact. OK, so in these cases, you have this. Yes, and in the cases where AN theorem, we can construct as many examples as you like of G2 not isomorphic to G1, but admitting a gamma 2 arithmetic length commensurable sub. So if I give myself G1 and gamma 1 arithmetic groups, then in cases G1 is of type AN D2N plus 1 E6. Yeah, so that was the question. In the excluded cases, do things fail or our methods fail? So the answer is things fail. So if you fix a G1 and a gamma 1 arithmetic of type 1 of these groups, one of these types, then you can find as many G2 as you like, which admit a gamma 2, which is length commensurable to gamma 1. Okay, and so weakly commensurable. So now one would wonder how many are possible. So the theorem is, given gamma 1, there are only finitely many commensurability classes. A gamma 2, which may be weakly commensurable. Yes, so gamma 1, gamma 2 arithmetic. Gamma 1 arithmetic, yeah, so. Gamma 2, yeah, so, you know, in the notation, gamma 1, gamma 2 arithmetic. So if you fix a gamma 1, then the possibilities for constructing gamma 2, which is not commensurable, exist because of the previous theorem, but there are only finitely many possibilities for a given gamma 1. But you can change gamma 1, and you can enlarge the possibilities. So that's what I meant earlier, as many as you want, but by changing gamma 1. But if you fix a gamma 1, there are, you see, the region is, so let me see what are the, so the reason why things happen is that if gamma 1, gamma 2 are weakly commensurable, then locally, so you know we are in arithmetic situation. Locally, the groups G1, G2 are isomorphic. So that's a basic theorem which we prove, that weak commensurability, you know, knowing some eigenvalues, somehow, not knowing meaning, just knowing that two eigenvalues are equal in some representation, tell you that the corresponding groups not only are of same type, but except for B and C and ambiguity. So the only ambiguity is same, B and C n. So let's assume that G1 and G2 are of same type. You know, well, the second theorem said that G1 and G2 have to be either of same type, or one is B n and the other is C n. So let's assume that they are of same type. B n and C n is real difficulty. And we know that it's a real difficulty in the sense that you can find locally symmetric spaces which are length similar. You can modify length of one by scaling so that the all lengths become equal to the other one. So let's forget about BN and CN ambiguity. Suppose these groups are of same type, then they are locally isomorphic. In number field situation, locally means you have defining number field and take various places, you know, various completions. And over each completion, the groups are same. But you see, if the groups don't admit outer forms, if there is no outer automorphism, then Hasse principle already tells you that local isomorphism means global isomorphism. But see, for type AN, DN, and E6, you know there is diagram automorphism, which means that there is outer automorphism. So because of the presence of outer automorphism, the Hasse principle fails. And it fails by finite amount. If you fix one form and look at all other forms which are locally isomorphic, then the failure is by finite amount. The other forms, they are only finitely many. You know, the failure of Hasse principle is finite. So that's what leads to this finiteness theorem, that things fail, but fail by finite amount if you fix the first group. Finally, I will say that gamma 1 co-compact implies gamma 2 co-compact. And this is again surprising. So, you know, we don't care to know anything about non-semisimple elements. The fact that gamma 1 is co-compact is equivalent to saying by Godema criterion for arithmetic groups that every element of gamma 1 is semisimple. And that somehow tells me that every element of gamma 2 must be semisimple. And you know, from length, we don't see this at all. I mean, you know, manifolds which are non-compact can have probably same lengths as manifolds which are compact. After all, long lengths, short lengths, they could all be there. But, and we don't see that at all. But you know, this theorem somehow sees that. So, you know, all this, actually the time is up, so I must stop, and I couldn't even tell you how these things are proved. But the method requires producing in a Zariski-dense subgroup in very, very interesting elements which produce tori made to order. You know, if I give myself maximal tori at finitely many places, then I can find elements in any thin Zariski-dense subgroup or thick Zariski-dense subgroup which give you these tori, not only at real place, but any finite number of periodic places. And it's really important to work with that.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, and